Very good and warm afternoon to you. We've just finished a very good interaction between the TU Delft students and the CEPT students. The focus is housing. Professor Yatin Pandya is conducting a housing studio here in at CEPT for a neighborhood in Ahmedabad. And Professor Dick van Gameren is conducting a studio in TU Delft. This week we have been together, and the accumulation of all this knowledge and more will be in the lecture by Professor Dick van Gameren. He's the chair of the architectural department at the TU Delft, my alma mater, and it's officially called the Faculty of Architecture and the Built Environment. Now, architecture department sounds smaller, but they have normally about 250 graduates a year. I'll just read out a small text and then I'll hand over the microphone to Dick. A building that is not linked to its surroundings is an obstacle. The key is the design of the open space in all dimensions. Forging new streets, creating squares and gardens, breaking up volumes. Connecting past, present, and future. Professor Dick van Gameren will explore the various relationships between buildings and their surroundings. A number of recent projects will be shown from him as a practicing architect with Mecanoo, based in Delft, to show how buildings and landscapes can be connected. Creating stronger sequences of open and closed spaces, articulating the movement through them. He will feature different projects, some in the Netherlands, some in Poland, some in London, and of course the very famous Dutch embassy in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. Please give a hand to Professor van Gameren. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Anne, for this nice and very clear introduction, because with this brief statement I can just show you some slides, maybe for you to judge whether indeed I really make in reality what I profess to do as said in the text. But okay, I will also use some words. But I want to say, first of all, that I'm very happy and honored to be here. I was here last year for the first time, almost exactly a year ago. I then gave a lecture on housing, Dutch housing, 100 years of Dutch housing, with some, as an extra bonus, some of my own projects at the end. This week, as Anne said, we have been talking about housing and housing, urban planning related to housing. We also had a wonderful afternoon session of lectures by the teachers and researchers from CEPT, and by us coming from Delft this week. Also about housing, but then focusing on affordable housing and on the situation here in India. So I'm not going to repeat all these things. I want indeed to show you a couple of projects. It's also hot, it's Friday afternoon, so let's keep it a bit not too theoretical. But what binds the projects together that I want to show is indeed this relation between the building and its surroundings, whether it's a natural landscape or an urban landscape, a cityscape. Because I do indeed believe that if you want to design a good building, it is maybe the most important thing is how this building becomes a part of its surroundings, how it integrates in it, and also how this building, if you design a really good building, how this building also manages to give extra more quality to its surroundings. So there's always a reciprocal effect. And I think that's very important, always to have that in your mind when you make a design. And I think last year I also at the end showed this picture, but I wanted to repeat it, because for me this is really the quintessential image of what I try to achieve also in my work. I don't know if any one of you knows this little building. It's not very well known. But it's a masterpiece of the English arts and crafts period. So it's built around 1900. It's called Stonywell Cottage. It's in Leicestershire, but that's all not that relevant. And it's designed by an architect called Gimson. And why is this for me such an important image? Because I think this shows so clearly how indeed a building can relate to its landscape. It's obvious that with its upward going shape, it follows the topography of the site, but there's much more to say about it. So the materials, the stone of the walls, the thatch of the roof, you can find them all within 50 meters of this building. So also the materials it uses, you could say, are part of the landscape it stands in and really becomes a part of. So you cannot just, let's say, move this building to another spot. It will only fit here. And I think that that's a very important quality to achieve. And another one, more a sideline, but with what I think is also important, and it relates to an anecdote about this building. So it was built around 1900, and a man who was living in the village where this small, it's a holiday home, by the way, a small holiday house. A man had left the village for like 5 or 6 years. He came back and then he saw this building and he said, "That's strange, I've never seen that building before." But it didn't come into his mind that it could be a new building. And I think that's also a fantastic quality, that it almost looks like that it is not designed, that there was not an architect involved, and that this building was already there for hundreds of years. And that's not only, of course, because it has a relatively traditional look, but it also, it looks so arbitrary, so undesigned, that it didn't come into his mind that this could have been a new building. But it is very carefully designed, because if you look in the archives and you see the working drawings of this building, every stone has been drawn, every little thing has been decided by the architect, but with the effects that a passerby thinks this building has always been there. And I think that's also an intriguing quality that architecture can have. I rather believe more in buildings that fit so well in their surroundings that indeed it gives this impression than a building that wants to be an icon, something that is completely unique, never seen before, which is maybe nice till a certain point, but if every building wants to do that, it becomes really quite horrible. So anyway, so this little building, I think, shows a number of important themes, aspects of architectural design. And I want to show with the first project. I worked on this when I finished my studies and I was an assistant at Mecanoo. Then for many years I had my own office, but now I'm back as a partner of Mecanoo. So I'm showing a project that I designed myself, but this is a nice project because it also goes back to my own history, but also because it shows something of my own context, which is of course very different from Ahmedabad. It's Delft, and well, I share that with quite a few people here in the room, also with Anne. And this is a fragment of an aerial photo of Delft, and it shows the campus of our university. TU Delft, University of Technology Delft, is the largest university of technology in the Netherlands, and it also has by far the largest school of architecture. And I want to talk about this space. A central road, and when Anna and I were studying here, it was like the shortest highway of the Netherlands, going from the historic town center in the north of the picture to nowhere, just to the polder landscape surrounding Delft. But it, the idea was the concept that it could be extended forever and ever, till you are in Rotterdam, in fact. And this is, of course, a typical modernist urban idea, putting infrastructure, car traffic, in the center, literally in the center. So what you see, there's this big road, and on both sides are lined up the buildings of a university. Here you can see the landmark building of a very iconic building, and one icon is really good, but you don't need too much, as I said. That's the main auditorium of the TU, and here you can see in construction the architecture faculty. But that building has gone. It was destroyed 8 years ago by a disastrous fire. And now we're in the building where you can just see the roof. But that's not what I want to talk about, but it gives you an idea where our students work, in what environment. But a couple of years ago, they started doing this 10 years ago, this road dramatically changed because everyone saw that this highway as the heart of a campus is maybe not a very good idea. And so there was a competition, and Mecanoo sent in this idea that was already developed 20 years ago when I was working there, to get rid of the road and make a central green space as a real connector of buildings. So also suddenly giving these buildings a position in the campus, and by very literally drawing all these lines to connect all the access points. And before that, you had to cross big parking lots to get to these buildings. So they were completely isolated, artistic objects. And by this intervention, we completely inversed the position of the buildings. So here another picture of how it used to look in our study times. And now it's about the same part what it is now. It's this green space, which is really a social space, a space to meet people. Because of course in the Netherlands, if there's a sun, we all go out and we go and sit in the sun. So you see it happening here. And it's a whole system of small lanes for bicycles, a lane for a bus. So there is public transport, but cars are not allowed anymore. But the idea started, as I said, already 20 years ago when we were working on the competition for a new library for the TU Delft. You can see it over here. And this is that auditorium building, that one iconic building of the university. And when we were working on that library competition, we also said we should not try to compete with the icon of Van den Broek and Bakema. They are the architects, the famous Dutch brutalist architects, 50s and 60s. We should not compete, but we should make a building that gives this auditorium an even stronger position in the campus of the university. So the building is part of this large green park, which is the heart of the campus. But strangely enough, in the end, it was built in the wrong order. First, the library was built, and then later this was done. But now it finally connects, and it really puts the auditorium in a central position as the hinge of the central green space of the TU Delft campus. And here you can see it. You have a view on the left of this auditorium building, this big brutal beast. And then the park simply continues, but as a sign, and indeed it's also, you could argue, a kind of an icon, but it comes out of the park, this volume that forms the heart of the new library. And so the building here really becomes part of the park, of the green landscape. You cannot distinguish them anymore. Here, building and landscape are one. And we make this big cut out in the sloping green meadow, that is the roof of the library, to get into the library. And it's a very popular place in the summer when there's sun, because then we go and sit outside, but also in the winter when we have snow. It doesn't happen so much anymore, but then we go sliding down on our sledges, which is quite dangerous, but it's very popular. And this is an image of the interior of the library, where you still have the experience of that big sloping roof, but then a large hall filled with books and study spaces. So I said I'm not really going to talk about housing, but I just want to show a few examples how also in housing, which is often dictated by economy, by systems, by repetitions, but still there, I think you should always try to find how housing connects to the city and how with housing you can create spaces that are not only the private spaces of the people who will live in the dwelling units, but that when you build, I think, also when it's housing, you always have to give back also some space to the city, to its surroundings. And this is an example of one of the first housing projects I built. It's already quite some years ago, in a typical Dutch context of all these little freestanding villas, semi-detached houses, row houses. So from the air it looks quite nice, but if you're on the streets it's super boring, because you could say all the space is privatized. Of course you have the streets, but then you have front gardens, the house, and the back garden, all fenced off with high fences at the back and a low one in the front. But there is hardly any, let's say, larger or collective space. And it's completely monotonous. It's only this low-rise housing. So this was a competition, and we said, let's make something different. Let's really squeeze these townhouses, row houses, and a number of apartments that we had to make together in three very compact clusters, so we can finally create some collective green space. Ah, yeah, I always like to walk, but maybe it's not good for the filmmaker. And here you can see it in a plan, so you see it's surrounded by all these small houses, and suddenly we have three larger blocks with green spaces, courtyards in between, with also a public route that is open during the day, and the fences can be opened, and you can walk through these gardens. So we suddenly added a space for all the people of this neighborhood. And this is how it looks, very simple. It's also three floors high as all the low rise, because that was fixed in a zoning plan. But we tied these three volumes together with a garden wall with large openings, so you can always see what's happening inside. But it suddenly becomes, yeah.
This is forward, backward, and
pointer.
Okay.
Okay.
This side, look up.
Yeah, the middle, yeah.
Push.
That's very clear. Okay. So suddenly we have this larger object in the middle of all these small private houses, introducing also the quality of green, collective, and publicly accessible spaces. Here another example. This is typically Dutch. This is an endless sea of houses. I won't go into detail, then it becomes again a housing lecture on housing. But you see all the row houses, and I made a masterplan for this part, and also design the houses. And then I said, hey, there's only one nice element in this site, that it's on the edge of this sea of houses, and there's this green space. So I said, the only thing we can do to give it an extra quality is to, let's say, interweave the housing with this green space. So like green and housing fingers that come together. And here you can see a sketch how we developed that idea, and in the end how it was exactly defined. And also the houses, they all relate also in their own plans, in their typology, to the green spaces. So when there are cars on the street between the open green space and the house, we lifted the living room, which is normally on the ground floor in Holland, to the first floor. So you have a good connection to the green space. And if there are no cars in between you and the green space, we simply put the living rooms on the ground floor. And we put large dormer windows in the roofs. The stairs are behind it, so if you walk down, you also look to these green spaces. And so I think also the idea of connecting the building and its surroundings and the landscape is also has a lot to do, of course, with view lines, with the visual element. And this is the last example in housing, is a project in the middle, in the center of Amsterdam. It's on the edge of the historic 17th century city. It's a master plan for again, housing with a lot of traffic, especially railroads here, it's produced a lot of noise. Oh, I have the pointer now, I'm sorry. And the idea of the master plan that was designed by Frits van Dongen is to create an apartment wall, so that behind that building there's a really quiet area a green area where there are small apartment buildings and small clusters also of townhouses. And the green spaces in between these little blocks then continue in a larger park strip that you see here. And what is very important about this in-between spaces that it's car-free. So all cars have to remain here on the streets, on the side, or you can park them underneath these large apartment blocks. But suddenly, yeah, you have the quality of living in the middle of the city in a green space. And this proved to be hugely successful, because there was a lot of argument. Is it possible? And I'm sure you have the same arguments here, maybe in a different way. Yeah? How is it safe? Can you have an open green space in the middle of your city? But here it proved very successful, and I think the main reason why it works is that all the housing is designed in such a way that the house is really open towards this green space. And I think we've also seen examples here in Mumbai where houses like in the traditional poles have this direct connection to the street. Sometimes they're really open, you can look in. That's really a super important quality that I think we really have to try to keep in our cities. And here it also made it possible, by making that direct connection, to make this space really work. Because the people who live there really see it as their own space. They even put their bicycles there, they put cages with rabbits, so it's really a kind of domestic landscape. But it's also public, anyone can go here. I think an important quality, certainly in a dense city. Yeah? And we saw that in a very different way also here. And this is one of the buildings I designed in this project, which is a mix. And that's another issue, but that more has to do with housing. But we also discussed that a lot this week about mixing. So this is a mix of very small apartments, cheap apartments for starters. You see them here. It's a sandwich building. So these two in between layers have these small apartments. And on top and below, you have family houses in two floors, maisonettes. I think it's also very important to think when you design housing to think about these mixes. Then I go, Anna already said it, to an example out of the Dutch context, where this idea of connecting landscape and building into one really became the driving force of the design. This is again an aerial view of now of Addis Ababa, of the site of the embassy. It's a beautiful green compound. It's a small remaining part of the original landscape. We often have with Ethiopia the idea that it's dry, it's a desert, and they have a big drought problem again, not in Addis. But large parts of Ethiopia, it's on a high plain, 2,500 meters above sea level, are extremely green and fertile. And also the capital is on that plain. So we found, after we won the competition, not with a design, but just by presenting an approach to the project, and we found this beautiful green compound. And in a typical condition, you see this is, Addis Ababa is a city of 90% slums. So it's a way different condition even than here, what we can find in India. I won't go into the story how that came about. It's very interesting, but well, you see it here, but this is more regular housing. This is some state-built housing now. And then in the middle of that, you find the compound and this, that's quite typical for what's happening in Africa, of course, that's a new ring road, just bulldozed through the city by a Chinese crew of road builders, without any mercy. This is, this yellow block shows where we made the main building of the embassy, because we had been given a brief by the client, the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs, to create several buildings on the compound. A chancery, which is the working place of the embassy, a residence, the house of the ambassador, a house for the vice ambassador, the second man in command, and some staff houses and some other spaces. Now, what was one of the most striking things for us when we went to the site is the big changes in level, the topography of the site. And that for us as Dutch was a wonderful change, because we always built a completely flat landscape. So finally, we had the possibility to work with the topography of a site. And it also proved to be the key to the design, because, well, we first went there a couple of times, you know, to investigate. You cannot immediately start designing a building here. You have to know what the local conditions are, how you can build, what materials are available and which are not. And of course, we also spoke with the people at the embassy. And it seemed they were all quite angry, because they thought it was a disastrous idea to have to live on the same site as they had to work. It's a kind of privacy obsession. And of course, these embassy people are often quite spoiled. So they thought, we don't want this. But the Ministry of Foreign Affairs was quite clear. This is a wonderful place. It's very expensive in Addis. They're like Mumbai prices. So we are simply going to do it. And then we made a plan, a master plan for the site, where we said we will use the topography to achieve maximum privacy. So the residents, here's the chancellery and the residence. They are one building, because that was part of the brief. But because this ridge in the landscape is going just over the volume, it bisects, it divides the volume in two parts. So if you're in the chancellery, you can never see the residence, and the other way around. So there's no privacy problem anymore. This is an old house that we restored for the second man. And here are the staff houses, and we put them also on the slope, so that the roof of one house is the garden for the next. So you can never look to your neighbors, you will never see them. And we also really push them to the edge, to give a maximum distance with the chancery and the residence. So that's how we use the landscape to make the buildings. And here you can see an image of when you are approaching the embassy, so you see the ring road. But most people still walk, so the ring road is quite empty. And you see the little gatehouse with the colors of the Dutch flag. And then you see this, the building, the chancery. It's the first building you see, where most visitors are. It's their destination. And what you see is a building that gradually comes out of the landscape, because it slides into the topography of the site. And maybe also good to say here, what is the material? It's concrete, because we found it's the only material that local contractors could really well work with. Wood is not available, steel is very expensive, brick has a very bad quality. So the only option was to work with concrete. And then we decided to do that, but not to clad it with stone or with plaster work. But thought we can give it a red pigment, and thereby again connect it in another way to the landscape, because if you take away the grass, you will see that the soil is very red. So in a way, this building also is then part of the landscape. Here you can also see it and how it disappears in this beautiful green space. You see the same. And there was another. Then we found out that by doing that, we could also connect it to something else, because the brief was quite clear, I mean about square meters, but there was also one other statement, that the building should represent Dutch culture, whatever that is, but also pay respect to the culture of the hosting country, Ethiopia. And of course, we went looking on our first travels. What is an Ethiopian architecture? Is there an Ethiopian architecture? And then we found out, and in fact it's quite famous, that Ethiopia has one very specific and quite unique building tradition, that's of the churches that are not built, but that are simply carved out of the soil, of the rock soil of the plain of Ethiopia. And this week I found in a bookshop a book about a temple here in India, which is more or less the same. I always thought it's unique, but you can find examples of this in India as well, I now found out. But anyway, what you can see, this is the most famous one example, is the St. George Church in Lalibela in the north of Ethiopia. You see the roof of the church is the level of the landscape, and this all has been excavated. Then the volume of the church was left over, and then you have to start digging out the interior of the church. But it's all one monolithic rock. And if you look for examples where buildings and landscape come together, this is of course the example, because here the building is really the landscape. There is no distinction. So by adding also that red pigment, bringing it back in the interior, which I will show you, we tried to make that connection to Ethiopian culture and architecture. Although our building, of course, is not excavated, but well, it disappears more or less in the landscape. So you can see the connection. And I think time-wise, I should not go too much into detail, but it's a very simple building. You can see the plan. This is where the landscape divides the building. At that point, a road is going over the roof. And this is the chancery. It's just one big corridor with offices on both sides. And this is the residence, also in two layers, because the roof is completely horizontal, but because of the slope, so in the middle, the building has a height of minus 50 centimeters. But here it's 7 meters high, so there we can make an extra floor. This is just show some photos. When you enter the building, it's a big cantilever, because in the rainy season, the ambassador or his guests or her guests want to get out of the car without getting wet. And then you arrive in the central corridor. It's a very simple, but in these collective spaces in the building, we use the same rough concrete with the pigment. So it also gives the whole building this very strong monolithic character, like the churches. But sometimes we opened up completely the volume of concrete and inserted or made a kind of incisions in the volume with big glass openings. Suddenly then the landscape comes in the building and the building becomes very transparent. So it's also a kind of play between closed mass and open transparency. But the workspaces themselves, like this meeting room, they have a softer cladding of wood panels, of plasterwork. But these collective spaces are made in the same way as the exterior. Then, at the beginning of this corridor, there's also a stair that brings you up to this upper level. So we are now standing on top of those stairs. And this also connects, in a way, to these churches that have all kind of carved out hidden stairs. And then you arrive at the ambassador's offices, and from that office there's another stair, a secret stair, like in the churches, and you go up to the roof. And then there's a path where the ambassador can walk over the building to his house that's on the other side of this green ridge where the road is also going over the building. And the roof gave us the opportunity again to play a little bit with this idea of Holland and Ethiopia. So the chancery on the right has a concrete relief, kind of sculptural top, which uses a motif of an Ethiopian cross, and the residence has on its top a Dutch polder landscape. So in the rainy season it fills, and then it starts to evaporate again, the water, and then you really see these patterns. Another aspect that determined the design is that we wanted to keep as much as possible the existing trees, and you saw them, they're quite spectacular. So it meant that we didn't want to make new roads. So the existing pattern of paths was completely preserved, and of course also in the end determining the exact position of the buildings. So this is the residence. Here I go again. Here you, on this side, the road is going over the building, and then it makes a 180 degree turn, and you go to the lower level, and here you have again a covered entrance where you can get out of the car to go to one of the receptions or dinner parties of the ambassador. Here you can see it a little bit closer. You can also see here a big stair that connects the upper road here with the lower road, which makes it possible for, if the guests are waiting here outside, for the ambassador to make a grandiose entrance as a little king in his own kingdom here. And then you arrive in this space and where you can wait or have a first chat with the other guests, and you immediately look out of the building. So here suddenly this heavy building becomes very transparent again. And then you come in a more enclosed space for a more private conversation. Then you go to the dining room, and from the dining room, which is on the top, you look out of the building, but you can also look down. So we made kind of sneaky connection with the private living spaces of the ambassador, which are on the lower floor here. And here you can see the end of that long structure, where as a kind of counterweight of the big cantilevering canopy at the front here, there's a large cantilevering terrace for the ambassador that goes, that hovers above a small, very deep ravine. Okay, this is probably the ultimate way how to, or how far we got at that moment with this idea of integrating building and its surroundings and context in many different ways. Now we go back to Holland, to the flat country, where we used the same devices, I think, that we used in the embassy in Addis to create a strong link between a house and its surroundings. Also here, quite a nice garden. This is a very beautiful part of the Netherlands, very close to Amsterdam, with a lot of villas. Here you can see, it's secret where it is, but we found out when we started the project, it's the Möbius house of UN Studio. Maybe some of you know it. But this was the house that we found. It was bought by our client, whom I knew because he lived at that moment in an apartment that was designed by me. And he called me and he said, Dick, I've bought a plot to build a new house, but there's also already a plan for the house, and it's a kind of neo 1930s villa, which is very popular in the Netherlands, but I don't like it, so what is your advice? And then he said, I want to do something sustainable. So I said, then the only thing you can do is keep the house, because maybe we can do some small improvements, but don't start throwing away all what's there already. And it set him thinking, and he said, yeah, that's maybe not a bad idea. But on the other hand, he said, it's very ugly. And also the interior was really nasty, so we really have to do something. And then we started looking in the history of the building, which you of course always have to do if you work in an existing context. And we found out that the house was built in 1967 as this, well, relatively nice bungalow, just one floor, in a kind of hexagonal pattern, inspired by Frank Lloyd Wright. But there the inspiration stopped because the details and the interiors are really awful. But the house was enlarged several times. So the garage was converted into a guest room, then a stable block was added. Here the kitchen was enlarged. Here more horses, more stables. Several enlargements, but it meant that the heart of the house, the hall and the living room, were relatively very small and had become very introverted spaces. So we said, okay, we can keep the house, but we have to do some drastic interventions. So what we did, and in black you see the old house, we said, okay, let's take out, with the Chinese bulldozer, you could say, the heart of the house, and we create a new central hall, a living hall in the house. And also the client wanted to have an extra living room, so we said, okay, we add another wing. So we get also more like a balanced butterfly plan with four wings and a central part, which is this new hall. And where The original hall was completely closed and introvert. As I said, the new hall opens to all sides. So even if you enter, you immediately look out of the house. And when you move into the house, you can see from all sides the garden. So we, in that sense, the spatial experience of the house was completely changed. But we kept what we thought was okay to keep. So all these bedroom wings and the kitchen were still there. And then we thought, this house is so low, so horizontal, so boring in a way. If we make this new heart, we also make a new roof and we add these three big skylights to give also a vertical dimension to the spaces in the house. How am I time-wise, Anne?
6-7 minutes.
Oh, then I... okay, I go fast. This is the house as it looks now. I'll skip the story of the garden, where we did also the reuse thing. So trees were replanted to get better view lines. But they were not killed. And here's one even in a patio in the house, to even enhance that idea of connecting in and outside. So again, you see four before and after the treatment from more or less the same position. This was the kitchen as it looked like, and this is the new kitchen. So we created this large view line to the other side of the house. But we really tried to reuse as much as possible. So the kitchen cupboard, of course, it got a new top, but the inside is the old one. And some more images of how the house, we made it as transparent as possible. This is the new sitting room. It's a glass pavilion. We made a conversation pit, really 1970s, but we thought it's really nice to have another perspective on the garden. So with a lower viewpoint, you really experience a green space completely different if you're more or less on eye level with the plants and the grass. And this is this central hall with the skylights that during the day give these changing patterns of light on the walls and the floors, which led the client to decide to put nothing in the space, which I think makes it a bit austere, but it's his house, so. And here's the house in the rain, which is, of course, a quite typical Dutch condition. I'm going to do now really fast, because there's another lecture coming on as well. This is an example, the ad-hoc of a master plan we made, where we use the same strategies of carving out volumes, creating view lines to embed, to really anchor a building in its surroundings. And in this case, it was really anchoring because it's a complex of buildings, the Court of Justice of Amsterdam, a hotel, apartments, offices that were built in the middle of the water. This is the main waterway of Amsterdam at IJ. And it was made here in the water, which is of course quite typically Dutch, that you just make new land. So we had this program and it was quite contested whether it would fit on this site. And we said, no, we are going to squeeze it, making it as compact as possible, one large volume. And then to turn it into a series of usable buildings, we cut out parts of this large main volume. And these parts, they use existing view lines from the existing city, like this, to the Shell Tower. Or here a view line from the Keizersgracht, other view lines. And by that way also anchoring it in the landscape of the city. And here you can see it in a diagram. So it's in Dutch, but you see the point of departure on the left, and then how we made these cutouts or incisions, and we ended up with five volumes, which had sometimes rather strange shapes. But that was also, of course, the fun, that it gave also each building its own identity, while at the same time really being one thing, because all the building heights are the same and the outside perimeter is also just one continuous line. And here you can see it. It was actually built. It took us 18 years, this project, but it was done. So the individual buildings are designed by other architects, and we were the master planner, and we had to guard the consistency of the whole project. So you can imagine we had quite some tough discussions with the architects, because of course they wanted to break out of this envelope. But we said, no, you can do anything as long as it you follow exactly the envelope, because that's the idea of the master plan, and that creates this consistency of the project. And of course, the most funny part is probably this little tower that is the result of all these sections, which is now an apartment with 9 floors, but the upper 5 floors only have a room of 2 by 3 meters. So it's not much, but it's quite spectacular. And here you can also see how this strange cutout, we call it the canyon, is in line with the Keizersgracht. Because if you stand on this bridge, you can still, at some point, you don't see the new buildings. That was another way of convincing people that it was possible to create so much volume on the edge of the historic town. Maybe now we couldn't do it anymore because it's now UNESCO World Heritage. But anyway, this is this view from the Keizersgracht. But you're just here, you see a glimpse of the building. But we didn't want to fill the whole horizon with our new project. Yeah. There's a marina in between the city and the new project. And you see the view line at the back, the Shell Tower, which is an iconic building in Amsterdam. And here you can see this very sharp corner of the apartment building. And it really introduces a scale that is not there in Amsterdam yet. The last project, 2 minutes, because I think this project is good to end with, because it really brings us back to the beginning, also to the design of the library. This is a competition that we won 3 years ago, together with Michael van Gessel, who is a very well-known landscape architect in the Netherlands. And the competition was to design the garden of the 21st century. And the project is in Poland, in what many people consider to be the most beautiful place in Warsaw. It's the capital of Poland. And indeed, it is a wonderful place. It's a historic park. It's a museum. But the nice thing of this museum, it's a collection of buildings in the park. And you can see some of these objects in these little pictures. So they're all old palaces, orangeries, small temples, all built in the 17th, 18th, 19th, partly 20th century. So it's really a collection of buildings. And the present director of the museum said, I want to add a 21st century garden and building, because it's not only buildings, but it's also gardens. And because you could never build in the real park, because it's heavily protected, but there was always a kind of leftover strip, which is the yellow one, on the edge of the park, and said that could be the location of this new 21st century garden. But it was not only a garden he wanted, he also wanted an exhibition pavilion, a quite substantial exhibition pavilion. And when we started working, we soon found out that if we would build that, that the garden would become really very small. So there was only one option, going underground with the exhibition pavilion and making the garden on top of it. And what you can see in the middle diagram, this park has a kind of crazy continuous network of paths, where you can really see the different times of the park, the formal 17th and 18th century, the romantic landscape garden 19th century, etc., etc. No time to go into that. And we added this very tiny, almost like natural network of very small paths in one continuous flower garden. Because for the rest, it's all grass and big trees. But we want to create something new, like maybe you're familiar with the work of Piet Oudolf. So it's just one continuous field of flowers that, after a few years, doesn't need any maintenance anymore. So with a careful selection of plants, you can create beautiful gardens that take care of themselves, that it always remains very varied with a lot of different plants. That's what we wanted to do as an idea of the 21st century garden. So a garden that can take care of itself and doesn't need men anymore, because we have already made too much interventions in nature as it is. So he said, we don't want that anymore. That's the idea of the 21st century garden. So this is the design. So you don't see a building, you just see this garden. And the garden is defined by a very low garden wall. And you can see it, but the garden is not flat. It undulates a little bit. And at some point, it really goes up 5-6 meters. It's in this part, but it's still in the plan, looks just like a garden. But that's where you will enter the exhibition hall. So you can see in this render, yeah, how this wall, the garden starts, and this is a wall of rough stone and concrete, and it goes up to create the entrance to the exhibition hall. Oh, sorry, and you can see it here. And we like that, not making a building, but really a landscape element. And you can also look at it as a typical 19th century garden feature, that of a grotto. So it's a kind of a fake grotto, and you enter to get into the exhibition spaces. You can see that here in the facade and the section. Yeah, so this is the roof of the exhibition pavilion, but it's also the garden, and then you have to go down 8 meters to get to the level where the exhibition spaces are. You can see it in plans, very simple central hall. This is the lower level with the exhibition space surrounding this central hall, and a big stair leading you to it. And finally, another image of this new garden in this historic park that is hiding this exhibition pavilion. And only at one moment we make a cutout of the garden, like in the Delft Library 20 years ago, where suddenly the building opens to the garden and where there's a small terrace. And we hope that they will start digging at the end of the year. Okay, that's it.
I think we have time for maybe 2-3 quick questions, because the next lecture is knocking on the door. Anybody?
Hi, thank you for the lecture, it was great. I wanted to ask you about this Amsterdam building master plan work. So what do you deliver? I mean, how did you manage to control a three-dimensional kind of a master plan?
Now, I will go back to an image of it. What we delivered is simply a drawing. Oh, I should stand here, I guess. What we delivered was quite simple, a drawing precisely defining the envelope of the buildings. And one A4 sheet with some rules about materials, the transparency we wanted, that was it, more or less.
And
a lot of meetings, it's also talking okay. and talking to the architects involved.
The amount of square meters that you can build and whatsoever, it was given, or you defined that?
The amount of facades?
The square meters that...
No, that was, we worked on it for 18 years, and while working on it, the programs changed radically. So when we designed it, the Court of Justice was not even an idea yet that it could come here. But of course, it's not completely arbitrary, this section, so we always took care that you have still, for the main volume, a kind of efficient volumes. And by doing that, we could, let's say, keep in the product also the smaller crazy parts. And what was good, that at some point it was precisely also defined in the zoning plan. So then also the clients wouldn't touch anymore these envelopes, because then they had to go through years of a process of years to get the master plan changed. Yeah.
Other questions?
I have a question about Villa 4.0. The extensions that are done in those in that field, they have taken consideration of the hexagonal shape of the existing structure. But the extension you did in the living room, that's a more square-shaped form.
Right? Yeah, we thought let's show that it's not part of that original structure. Eh? If we go back quickly to the plan. But it follows, let's say, the lines that are already in the building, only we didn't literally make it again into a hexagon. And even, I mean, it in this drawing, it's still a square conversation pit, but that was in the end a pentagon. So to play a little bit with this shape.
Yeah.
So it's really not wanting to be too dogmatic about what there was.
Okay. And then another small question about the row houses you designed.
Yeah.
We talked a lot about the big amount of open green space that are actually, because of the size of it, it's not getting really used. How did you manage that? Like, is that place, is that leftover space, is it now used or is it empty? Is it
just
green?
I think it's certainly used. It's full of children playing football and things like that.
Because it was a lot big and...
I think it's all, again there, also with this low rise, with this intertwining thing.
Exactly.
It's if the green space really becomes part of your direct living environment and then preferably car free, then it's really very well used. But if it's an isolated thing and you have to cross a road, etc., it's a completely different story.
Final question?
Yeah, the next audience is waiting.
A small question about the iDock, because I've been there a few times and I was always wondering what happens in this small corner. Was it not possible to maybe move the line, the sideline a bit to get bigger space in that one small thing?
Why should every space be large? A small space can also be nice. It would, It's a complicated story, but it was really the result. I mean, these sections, as I said, they are not as arbitrary as you think.
Yeah.
So it was not possible, let's say, to do it differently. At least that was my story to the client, of course, and now to you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Give him a warm applause.